Paul. Great to see you.
Great to see you, Dallas.
Thank you very much. Come take a seat.
Thank you.
Why are we excited about hydrogen?
Think of hydrogen as the one bit that reaches all those parts of the energy system that the direct electrification has trouble reaching.
So basically the things that batteries can't power.
Exactly. It's that soft boundary between how far electrification kind of can reach and where you need a molecule, whether it's providing really high grade heat in industrial processes, whether it is as feedstock, or it is indeed for those kind of transport sectors that we call hard to abate.
Things like steel manufacture, things like concrete, the kind of invisible things, if you like, of life that people don't quite realize are really, really carbon intensive. Yeah. How viable is something like hydrogen in terms of scale, in terms of actually scaling it up and actually getting it done?
So one of the key things is actually getting the right demand signals and actually getting the use cases to pull through the rest of the value chain. I think we're seriously now looking at an inflection point. And the two reasons for that is that the cost of renewables are continuing to come down.
Yeah.
The second piece, I think, is really around how serious the world is around decarbonizing, also those sectors that are hard to get at. But I think the engagements that we have day in, day out with big customers, whether they are steel makers, the big transport companies, the big shipping companies, they are very serious about the need to decarbonize. These are real serious kind of commitments that people are making around getting to net zero. So you need to bring the customers along, and very often you need to bring our customers' customers along.
Yeah.
The reason people talk about green steel, for instance, right? Steel with a lower carbon footprint is that we believe that the automotive manufacturers are a big enough market to saying we can persuade our customers to pay a little bit more if that car is actually made out of zero carbon steel.
Yeah. How does it work? Is it that you find small companies or people that you're interested in?
Typically, you want to have a mix and you want to actually work from the customer backwards. And then you find within each sector, there's probably a few leading companies that are willing to lean in a little bit more than the rest. And then you latch on to some of those bigger customers and jointly, together with the OEMs, the people who build the equipment, and policymakers, you then say, well, what now needs to happen? And then typically it starts with what I call like tram rails or corridors, where you're saying, well, let's not try to solve the problem at once.
What is Shell doing and how is Shell involved in all of this?
So we're very committed to playing almost like an architect role of bringing partners together, whether that is policymakers, OEMs, as well as bringing our customers along in building this hydrogen value chain.
You're the conducting the orchestra.
Absolutely. And I think also then in the spirit of partnership, orchestration also means that you're not just trying to build this entire value chain yourself. You're going to be reliant on partners. You're going to be reliant on customers and OEMs. You're going to be reliant on governments.
Can you give us a few examples of projects that Shell's involved in?
So one example would be a green hydrogen plant that we built in China. All of the buses at the Winter Olympics were actually hydrogen buses, all supplied by an integrated project where we built an electrolyzer, and then the whole kind of supply chain for getting these buses to kind of travel around. So one that I'm particularly excited about as an aerospace engineer is ZeroAvia, where we made a small investment in a startup company that is actually looking at how hard is it really to fly on hydrogen. And, you know, it's one of those areas where you could either pay a consultant a lot of money to see where does this sector ultimately go, or you can actually learn with the front line of, you know, seeing how the flight tests evolve and how the hydrogen is being used in this case, in a relatively small kind of propeller plane.
Looking ahead, is there one particular problem that keeps you awake at night? What's the biggest challenge, do you think, from where
I think
we are
the biggest
today?
Challenge is I think the willingness maybe to get through. So there's a lot of, as I said, a lot of tailwind at the moment. There's a lot of momentum building for hydrogen. We need to kind of have the commitment, the patience to work through that phase where maybe not everything is going to work first time.
Yeah.
We've got more than 120 years of experience in building energy systems, understanding how they operate, how they not just function, but how to make them more efficient and more affordable and more robust. So we see taking a very similar role in building out the hydrogen ecosystem.
From what I gather, like Shell's been involved in this for a
We've
long
been in this for,
time.
For decades. And this goes back kind of two decades, you know, 20, 25 years when the first kind of hydrogen business was created. Now is the window of opportunity to get this right.